down to dinner in his Sunday best. Excitable boy, they all said. And he puffed a pot roast all over his chest. Excitable boy, they all said. Well, he's just an excitable boy. He took little Susie to the junior prom. Excitable boy, they all said. And he raped her and killed her, then he took her home. Excitable boy, they all said. Well, he's just an excitable boy. And after 10 long years, they let him out of the home. Excitable boy, they all said. And he dug up her grave and built a cage with her bones. Excitable boy, they all said. Well, he's just an excitable boy.
The strange verses, I think. Good
morning. It's Warren Zevon in the studios this morning of WMMS on the Coffee Break Concert. And good song. It's a brand new tune. What's it called?
The Excitable Boy.
It figures. Warren Zevon is, to do a quick biography here, is an L.A. songwriter-singer. I'm going to turn the phrase around because he's known for writing his tunes, and a lot of people have used them over the years. And Linda Ronstadt's new album is an example, a title tune, Hasten Down the Wind and all that. How do you feel doing a lot of the same music about the same topics that L.A. Desperados do and yet kind of throwing it back in their faces? Do you get any flack from your friends is what I'm saying?
No, not at all, because neither my friends nor I look at it that way. It never occurred to me. I know what you're talking about, and I've seen it in, in the media, but it never occurred to me that I was satirizing. If it sounds like Los Angeles music, it's probably because I'm primarily an Angeleno, and it just sounds that way. And as for the topics, that doesn't strike me as being, deliberately that kind of subject matter. I write about whatever I'm doing, wherever I am.
The humor, though, definitely takes precedent over everything, I would think, or over a lot of what you're doing. And just wondering if your friends feel as though he's parodying us. He's making fun of us.
No, it would no more cross their minds than mine, really.
All right. Well, everybody's on the album.
Simple as that.
And I know they couldn't have worked with you on the material and, sung backups and all that if they wouldn't have really dug what you're doing. All right. Now, the person who got you in the studio is Jackson Brown.
That's right.
How long have you known him? What was the association?
That was a 7-piece band that used to play in California. No, I've known Jackson for about 8 years.
It's a long time.
We kind of talked about doing this album for several years now.
Yeah, I guess you had to be chased down in order to kind of dragged into the studio in order to record this thing. You were spending some time overseas.
I didn't have to be dragged, but...
Were you happy when you heard about the opportunity?
Yeah, it was the way I wanted to do it. I really didn't want to do it except the way I wanted to do it. With Jackson producing it and on Asylum was how I wanted it. And the people who were playing with me.
Couldn't ask for more, I guess, for a first, not the first recording, actually. That's another point.
Oh.
We could go back into that thing you don't even want to talk about.
Stuff up.
From 19, what,
I don't
69,
want to talk about
70.
It.
There you go, okay. We just mentioned it. Warren Zevon, could you play another tune?
Yeah, what would you like?
Well, I have scotch and water. Anything.
Scotch and soda, I don't know. It's jazzy. This is probably, this is an important song to me. It's one of my favorites.
I was sitting in the Hollywood Hawaiian Hotel. I was staring in my empty coffee cup. I was thinking that the gypsy was a lie. All the salty margaritas in Los Angeles, I'm gonna drink them up. And if California slides into the ocean, like the mystics and statistics say it will. I predict this motel will be standing till I pay my bill. Don't the sun look angry through the trees? Don't the trees look like crucified thieves? Don't you feel like desperados under the eaves? Heaven help the one who leaves. I'm still waking up in the mornings with shaking hands, and I'm trying to find a girl who understands me. But accepting dreams, you're never really free. Sun look angry through at me. I was sitting in the Hollywood Hawaiian Hotel. I was listening to the air conditioner hum, and it went
that into visual part of that performance, but I'll take your word for it.
Yeah, it was really good. Thank you. That's a closing track on the Warren Zevon album, Desperados Under the Eaves. And you know, right away the Eagles come to mind, Desperados and all that, but yet they don't show up. None of them show up on that tune, which I was surprised, because I would have thought that one of them would have been on that tune. Yeah. I guess it doesn't matter.
It's really got nothing to do with the Eagles.
Nothing to do with the Eagles.
No.
I guess it's just anybody.
Well, I guess we used to drink in the same bar, but as far as as far as the
little bit of insight
connection goes.
You're originally from what, Chicago?
I was born in Chicago.
Born in Chicago. How long did you live there, and how long you been out in L.A.?
I've been around L.A. for almost all my life.
So you're pretty much a part of it.
28, 29 of my life has been in L.A.
Yeah.
Lived mostly out west, north, and south, and around. I was in Chicago for about 3.5 hours, I think. Not long enough to form a clear impression.
Your music is of a certain kind. I guess you could call it, what do they call it? L.A. country rock, I don't know. Could think of a lot of terms, I guess. But what you first started playing when you were younger was classical music?
Yeah.
How did you study it, or did you study it, you know, formally? Did you just pick it off of records like kids pick up rock and roll, or what?
Yeah.
Really?
As a matter of fact, yeah, I've really never had any kind of formal training. In a sense, I guess that's well put. Yeah, I picked it up off records like you do rock and roll or anything else.
But there's a lot more to pick up off classical recording.
Oh, true. I did have to learn how to read music and play some piano.
I read something in one of these little interviews that I've seen, or reviews, about you starting a classical piece that you have yet to finish, or it might be finished by now. And
no, it's not finished yet.
It's not. It's 3 minutes long, by the way, is what I heard. Is that true?
No, that was that young man's interpretation of the
okay.
Maybe 3 hours long.
Is it something?
Remains to be seen.
Would it be something that you might consider releasing, you know? Like the second Warren Zevon album or something like that?
Yeah, I don't see any reason why an artist can't, you know.
There's no record company pressure that says, hey, get out some singable tunes or something?
Not this company.
That's good.
So, I don't know. I mean, that's conceivable. It seems a little far-fetched, but that's conceivable to make a Warren Zevon album that's a, you know, Symphony in F or whatever it turns out to be.
Oh, yeah, I was going to talk about your album, and Jackson Brown produced it, and he kind of produced it like I guess he would produce his own stuff. Your music is sort of similar anyway. And yet, when you do your live stage show, and you've gotten good reviews, probably better reviews, I don't know, for your live stage show, it's an all-out rock and roll affair, pretty much. Is that what causes that difference? Are you happy with what Jackson did with your album?
Yeah.
That you've done something different?
It's an interesting phenomenon that I'm sort of making a study of. Playing live, we do play sort of like a simple, straightforward hard rock, and I guess the album's a little more elaborate than that. But it's not really valid to take a live act and just walk into a studio and knock it off like you would a show. You know, the studio is not the same place as... Yeah. As a place where there's 100 people or 1,000 people.
A lot different.
The conditions are different, and therefore, if you try to pretend they're not, then you're not really recording music, I don't think. Do you follow me?
Yeah, I get the idea, but how do you play to a tape machine? Do you feel like you're being restrained?
No, but what I'm saying is that you do play a different way. You approach the songs a different way.
Yeah, it's the same tunes.
Different considerations. Yeah, the same tunes. If you play them on a jet engine and a typewriter and an oboe, it's still going to be the same song. But you can't just, you know, as valid as nice as it is just to perform, it's a different kind of performance in the studio. You have to be kind of geared up a different way.
Your flexibility is limited. Well, in the studio, you can take it over and do another one on top of it and all that stuff. And I don't know, somehow, I would think the stage is more demanding, you know.
I'm not so sure.
Well, from this standpoint, that the contact has to be made right then and there. You can't erase it and start over, or do another one on top of it, make it better, make it double or whatever.
Yeah, but that knowledge keeps you on the edge. In fact, that's what's, you could point it out again, it's kind of what... The problem with recording music, I don't know if for me or for anybody, is that the knowledge that if you mess it up, you can do it over.
Glad you used
actually
that
makes
word.
It, oh, messed. You sensed what I... Yeah, I'm not even restrained.
It's Warren Zevon visiting this morning on the Coffee Break Concert. It's really a pleasure to have you down here. Thanks for taking time out of what must be a real hectic promotional tour. Are you concertizing along the way?
No, not at all. I'm just with... This gentleman who looks sort of like a deranged Dustin Hoffman is the iconoclastic recording company man would alter all your ideas about recording companies. Bert Stein, Bert and I just kind of flying around. And
but are you having
visiting
a good time?
And, oh, I always have a good time. I always have a good time.
Can you play another tune?
Let's see.
We brought in our Higby's piano. I think it was Higby.
Oh, this is a Higby?
I guess so.
No, it's in Everett.
Everett.
Mount Everett. Speaking of my friends, maybe I kind of like to attempt to play a song by John David Souther that I'm very fond of. What if I fell in love with you just like normal people do? Maybe I'd kill you, and maybe I'd be true. When I go down to get a job sometime, it seems like people can read my mind and make money disappear while they're talking sweet and kind. Well, in some ways, I am like a child. Though you never seem to know it. And if a kind word ever crossed your mind, you never let me know it. When people don't know what you mean, they may laugh at you and call you green. Say your words are stupid and your dreams are only schemes. Let no one come between. Simple man, simple dreams.
tune. You guys sound like you're a family. Your record label, or maybe not necessarily just your record label, but the folks on the album and people you work with. You sound like you're a big happy family. Is it really like that?
I guess so.
Really?
Yeah, I hadn't thought of it that way, but it's nice. They're nice people, you know.
I guess everybody's pretty much around the same age. Roughly,
I would say.
Been through the same recognition process.
Probably.
Yeah.
Probably.
Do they have you pegged over there at that record company saying, hey, he's the next one? Do they make demands on you? Do they place expectations?
They don't think that way. I guess part of that family thing is that I think there's something a little different about this record label. There isn't that kind of pressure, and there isn't that kind of, are you going to make a hit single, and what are you going to do? And
Yeah.
You know,
do you have a clear-cut thing in your consciousness where you want to be, you know, do you want to sell a million records? Is that a prime objective, or are you thinking in terms of just, you know, being happy to write tunes for anybody?
Well, I think anybody, any writer worth his salt or worth anything would write on a, stranded on a desert island, you know, to entertain himself.
Especially then, probably.
If you don't feel that way, then you really shouldn't be. It's okay to do it, but you shouldn't be foisting it off on other people. On the other hand, though, I guess the idea of a million people listening to a song that you've made up is...
There's nothing wrong with it.
It's a nice idea. No, sure. Nothing wrong with that at all. I wouldn't object to that.
How about your rock and roll influences? You know, or non-classical things that you listened to when you were, you know, a kid?
Gee, I don't know.
Were they things that stuck with you, or was it just a parade?
Well, there were always things that... I was folky. I went through that. Ran away from home, went to Greenwich Village, and lost all my finger picks in the hole of my guitar. My first night as a folk singer. I went through a period like that, and I don't know. I sort of learned to play guitar backwards, too, and didn't want anybody to show me how to finger those chords right. Not that I'm advocating this approach to a musical career to your listeners, but I kind of went about things strangely. I guess the Beatles era had its influence on me. And also, I guess you know, man, you know, I played with the Everly Brothers for a couple of years. Yeah. A few years ago.
You toured with them, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.
Did you do some work with Phil Everly on one of his...
Yeah, I arranged a couple of his albums.
Yeah, there you go.
In fact, I'll never forget playing Cleveland with the Everly Brothers.
Is that a thing? When was this?
Oh, about 72, I guess. The club burned down. Really? They kept singing, you know. We wanted to keep the audience calm as they left. It was an electrical fire, and, you know, they smoke the worst.
Yeah. They really smell pretty bad, too.
So I was just, you know, playing like... You know, playing to light my fire, keep them calm. Keep everybody's spirits up.
Why not? This is the Coffee Break Concert on WMMS. Warren Zevon is staying
with... 3 hours sleep a week club.
Congratulations. Get a membership card when you leave. Can you do another song? And you said, you know, I could choose a request, so I'm going to ask you to do if you can. How about Poor, Poor, Pitiful Me?
Okay. This right. Compromise I'll make.
All right.
This I should play an electric guitar.
You can hum?
But I will try to play it on the piano. We'll see how it works out. Poor, poor.
just like Jesse James. She didn't work, be over good. She was a credit to her gender. She put me through some changes, Lord, sort of like a whammy blender. Mercy on me. Close me. I met a girl at the Rainbow Bar. It's in L.A. She asked me if I'd beat her. She took me back to the Hyatt House. I don't want to talk about it.
Percussion with my wedding band.
You're doing okay. Sounds real good. This is Warren Zevon stopping in today here at the studios of MMS. And Warren's come out with, I guess you might as well call it, I know what he wants to call it, his first album. Well, put it this way, first album in a long time.
Lately.
Lately, yeah. Recently. Were you surprised at the really, really good reviews that it got? And people were throwing around a lot of heavy phrases, you know, kind of using, I don't know, revolutionary type language, you know, saying new concepts and a new outlook and a totally new sound and real fine songwriter, real exciting and in concert. Were you surprised at the, you know, sudden reaction like that? You expected it all the time.
No, I'm not saying that either. You'd be surprised how little your life changes. You know, just because of a certain amount of recognition or success or something. I hope, you know, I don't think it's... A year ago I was singing in a bar in Spain, an Irish bar in Spain owned by an American soldier of fortune, he claimed. And I was happy then, you know. I'm happy now.
That's the best way to be, I guess. But you weren't... If it would have been a lot tamer, let's say, the response to the album, if it had been cold, would you have been hurt? Disappointed? Or...
Well, I don't know. That's a good question. I guess it's possible. I don't know. It would depend on what they said. Someone said that a song was about, one of my songs was about something that the song actually has nothing to do with, and that kind of, that irritated me a little. It was in the context of a very favorable review, so I was grateful, and I, you know, didn't write any nasty letter or anything, no, but that sort of stuff, you know, and glaring inaccuracies and interpretations kind of gets to me just a little bit. But otherwise,
a lot of your songs are very personal, though, and I would think that the interpretation would be open up to the listener.
Yeah, this was kind of an irresponsible opinion, I felt.
I see.
But like I said, you know, I won't say where you might have read it. It's in the context of a favorable review, but it just kind of, you know, I was telling people the song was about something the song had nothing to do with.
I see.
Like that assumption that if I write a song called with Desperados in it, it must be a satire on the Eagles.
Right.
And maybe I wrote it 10 years ago, you know, or a year before.
Okay, yeah, that could totally change the whole thing around, for sure. Did you have fun recording the album?
Yeah, a lot of fun.
All right. Now, and it seems as though you've been having fun on stage, too. Joy.
Well...
Which do you like better?
Recording or playing?
Yeah. So I know you do tinker around in your own studio, and I know you must enjoy recording.
Yeah, but they're too different to make a comparison. You can't really A and B that. Right. I enjoy them both very much. I didn't, then it wouldn't be worth listening to me.
I guess not.
But I couldn't say that I liked one better than the other. They're different.
How about, you know, like maybe a tour in the future? Are you getting that kind of ready?
I think in a few weeks, yeah.
Do you have any locations picked out in advance or any?
Not really that I know of.
Let's see what happens. The album's just been released, what, 2 months ago? Month and a half? Something like that.
Something like that.
It's been getting a fair amount of reaction around the country, and I suppose things, we'll see what happens. What do you say, I guess? As a man who's had a lot of years and experience doing a lot of different things, you were an undertaker at one point.
Now, wait a minute.
No, you were an honorary coroner, I think is what they used the phrase.
Yeah, well, I haven't been back to Aspen to check on the stiffs lately, but I did. A friend of mine, actually, Aspen's kind of a strange town. And part of my family lives there. My wife's family lives there. And I better clear this up when this wasn't one of these magazines. I better straighten this out. Late one night in the Jerome bar, this friend of mine who was a candidate for county commissioner, I asked him if I could be coroner if he made it, you know. Very serious. Everybody in Colorado looks like Robert Redford, you know. This guy was Robert Redford with a beard and scratched his head. Very serious. Said, well, Zevon, so-and-so is going to step down. It is an appointment. Okay, coroner. Now, he lost the election.
Oh, no.
But the man who won cacked or something, you know, a heart attack or something. So my friend was appointed. So in theory, I think I can, you know, I haven't been back to demand the
What are your
honors.
Duties? What are your duties, Duke?
Jeez, let's not think about it.
All right. It's too early in the morning, yes. Warren, how about another tune?
Ah,
I hate to keep pestering you, but, you know. We've got about, a good part of almost a half an hour, which means it's about 11:32 on a Wednesday morning. Looking for the bottle of tequila?
Yeah, I'm gesturing through the booth.
Right. Somebody bring it around. I think they took care of it themselves. No, it's coming.
Another tune. Well, what would you like to hear, man?
Melancholy Baby. No.
How about it? No, I don't know that one.
Mohammed's Radio.
Okay, that's good. All right. Sensible.
Reasonable, huh?
Yeah, I was trying to play as time goes by. I remember that. I like that poster there, man.
Everybody's restless, and they got no place to go. And someone's always trying to tell them something they already know. So their anger and resentment flow, but don't it make you want to rock and roll all night long? Mohammed's Radio. Radio, Mohammed's Radio. I suppose Jimmy Carter's got his problems too. He will surely take them out on me and you. Now here comes the village idiot, and his face is all aglow. For he's been up all night listening to Mohammed's Radio. Don't it make you want to rock and roll all night long? Mohammed's Radio. I heard somebody singing sweet and soulful on the radio. Mohammed's Radio. Everybody's desperate, trying to make ends meet. They work all day, still can't pay the price of gasoline and meat. Alas, their lives are incomplete. Don't it make you want to rock and roll all night long? Mohammed's Radio. Reprise Radio. I know you've been up all night listening for his drum, hoping that the righteous might just come. I heard the general whispering to his aide-de-camp, be watchful for Mohammed's lamp. Don't it make you want to rock and roll all night long? Mohammed's real. I heard somebody singing sweet and soulful on the radio. Mohammed's radio. Mohammed's radio.
Real good. And success. All right. Sounded real good. I really enjoyed it. It's Warren Zevon sitting in today here on the Coffee Break Concert. WMMS, probably somebody you'll be hearing more of as time goes by, because you really don't know, they don't tell you who the name is of the guy who writes the music for the Gallo wine commercials or whatever, the Boone's Farm or whatever, stuff like that, which is just a small part of Warren's past, I know.
Very small part.
Very small part. It's a tough business, it's a competitive business, and you have to stay alive any way you can, I guess, is, you know, at certain points. And when you can finally have the opportunity to reach out and, you know, affect some people the way you really want to, it's got to be a real upper.
Yeah, well, the Gala wine bit qualified that, too. I do take a certain amount of naughty pleasure in it, but actually I crossed them. I played sort of a practical joke on the agency, and they weren't amused. It's a long story.
All right. Your music has been looked at as being, at times, you know, like, what's that word? Intellectual. Do you worry about going over people's heads?
No, I think that would be pretentious or I don't know, assuming a lot. I don't think in terms of I'm going over nobody's head. I mean, I'm sure you've been struck with my intellectuality, Matt, in this discussion here. But no, it doesn't occur to me. I didn't think about going over people's heads.
Do you see yourself as an intellectual?
I don't know. What's that mean?
Smart person.
that's not for me to say. If it means if you like to read books and stuff, go to the pictures, take in a little, you know, Shostakovich here and there, maybe.
Yeah.
How about drinking tequila? Does that make you an intellectual?
Yeah, it helps. It makes you very wise real quick.
let's see.
Drink to your wisdom is what that all boils down to. I think they... Do they boil that? No, they do something else. How about another tune? I'm getting kind of crazy here.
And you want me to bail you out?
Yeah, right, exactly.
I was hoping you'd keep talking. Hey, here's an amusing little tune that Jackson Browne taught me.
That's quick. It's a minute waltz in 48 seconds or something like that. What is that?
I don't know.
Just a little noodle.
A little cakewalk.
There you go.
Actually, it's Cindy Cindy.
Cindy Cindy.
You remember Cindy Cindy?
No, I don't. I'm sorry.
Well,
if you've been born in or lived or grew up in New York City, would your songs have been remarkably different, do you think?
They'd be about New York City instead of being about Los Angeles.
Would they still be set in
but
bars?
But they're not all about Los Angeles. I mean, the album, we didn't want to make a... No Tommy, you understand, no serious concept album, but the unifying theme was about Los Angeles experience. The next album will not be about that at all.
What are you going to delve into? Surrealistic images? I mean, totally dreamland things? Or?
You know, well, my life is a little surrealistic, but the images are, you know, drawn as accurately as I'm able to. It'll be about the period of my life that takes up where this album leaves off.
Yeah, there are a couple autobiographical tunes. I guess Frank and Jesse James involves part of your life. And what's the one?
Most of them are. I'll disclaim a couple.
Oh, okay.
But, for the most part. Mama couldn't be persuaded to speak the autobiographical. My parents were not thrilled. In fact, my mother seldom writes, but did write me a letter saying, "We like your album. We're proud of you. But I want to talk to you about this tune."
That's great.
I assume you think that this is autobiographical, this piece of work. Let me set the record straight, writes Mom.
Your mother's got to be your greatest critic, then. She's got all the insights into...
Well, she ain't my biggest fan.
Could we hear that tune? Can you do that?
I could try.
All right.
Again, you know, I just kind of have to get reoriented to playing alone.
Imagine some bass and drums and guitars and vocals
definitely
in the background.
Definitely makes it more
there.
Fun. I have to try and remember what part so-and-so is playing and stick it in if I can. That is one of the most exciting things about having the record do it reasonably well is I do sort of have a band now.
Right.
That's swell. They are fine musicians.
Small outfit, by the way, isn't it? It's just, what, three of you?
Yeah, we'll keep it that way.
That's everybody's got to pull their weight in a situation like that.
Yeah. And do. I hope that I'll have the same band the next time I go out as I did last time.
I want to hear you. One way or another.
So, we were talking about my genealogy, weren't we? Percussion.
Country lane, looking for a game of chance. She was 21 or 2 and she knew what she wanted, and she wanted that gambling man. The parents warned her, tried to reason with her. She was determined that she wanted Bill. They'd all be offended if I mentioned Still, if they heard this song, which I doubt they will. And my mama couldn't be persuaded when they pleaded with her daughter, don't marry that gambling man. Mama couldn't be persuaded when they pleaded with her daughter, don't marry that gambling man. Mama couldn't be persuaded when they pleaded with her, no, no, nevertheless. Said my mama couldn't be persuaded when they pleaded with her daughter, don't marry that gambling man. Tried to be a family man, though it didn't suit his style. He thought he had him a winning combination, so he took us where the stakes were higher. Her parents warned her, tried to reason with her, never kept her disappointment hid. They all went to pieces when the bad luck hit. Stuck in the middle, I was the kid. Mama couldn't be persuaded when they pleaded with her daughter, don't marry that gambling man. Mama couldn't be persuaded when they pleaded with her daughter, don't marry that gambling man. Mama couldn't be persuaded when they pleaded with her, no, no. Nevertheless, they told me mama couldn't be persuaded when they pleaded with her daughter, don't marry that gambling man. Waddy, where are you?
Okay. Sounds real good, even without all the backup and all the folks on the album.
That's the gist of it.
Did your folks, you know, persuade you or kind of help you along in music when you first showed an interest and say, hey, go ahead, you know, learn how to play piano?
Well, I don't know. I can't really say they discouraged me. I guess my mother kind of encouraged music and played it around the house, and somewhat. I think I'm supposed to have some kind of uncle who plays the clarinet somewhere. You know, I wasn't regarded as a degenerate. Yeah. My father, on the other hand, told me to... He calls all musical instruments banjos. He said, either you or the banjo goes. So, we went.
There's a lot of folks on the album. We were getting it at. Like, yeah, I could just go on and on naming the names. Phil Everly and, Carl Wilson of the Beach Boys is here. And Bobby Keys, Ned Doney, a whole lot of really good session people. And, you know, I'm just looking for the names here. But how did you get them all, you know, persuaded to come out on your album, you know, as opposed to anybody else's and all together at the same time?
Just lucky, I guess.
Just lucky.
I don't know. There were people who... They were all, like, kind of logical, inevitable choices for the songs that they, you know...
Just kind of picked... you got to pick your backup people, whoever was necessary.
Yeah, and they're just all... They are all
Jackson
all
Brown
friends,
produced,
you know,
it and all that. Who's in your road band?
Well, the road man band may be the band we go in the studio with next time.
Oh, I didn't
know
that.
I mean, there's not... I don't like to make that qualify. I've been in that position. I've been a sideman, so I don't like to qualify it and say that there are musicians you go in the studio with, the musicians you go on the road with. Mickey McGee has been playing drums with me.
Okay.
Mickey McGee and Doug Haywood plays bass. And,
You like the rock and roll sound on stage, yeah? That's what really gets you going on stage. It turns into a rock and roll show.
Yeah.
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 I like
to rock and roll.
How about like a future album? You're saying you're going to go in the studio with these three folks. Would it be rock and roll?
You know, you can't tell until you do it.
True.
You can get a lot of preconceived ideas, but whether or not and how you'll do it and whether we'll, you know, go in with an acoustic guitar and a string quartet instead, anything's possible. But I have a feeling it might be a kind of compact rock album in the sense of, you know.
You said some of your influences are read somewhere. We're also some of the English blues rock bands, like the Yardbirds, I guess.
I went crazy for a while. Me and my fuzz tongue were inseparable.
I was
determined to be the king of acid guitar.
Sure.
Or at least the prince.
I've not heard you on live. Okay, so I don't know what you sound like. Is there any sort of a description you can give us?
No, that's really putting me in a funny position, man. I don't know how to describe.
Is it,
what can I tell you?
The country rock?
Like Creedence Clearwater, if Norman Mailer was the lead singer, and they all, you know, what am I going to say?
That's good.
All right, okay, let's go with that.
For sure. All right, this is turning out to be a pretty fun hour. Hey, listen, there's only 10 minutes left, and it's going by real quick. Warren Zevon is our guest this morning on the Coffee Break Concert. As I said, you'll be hearing more about him as time goes by. It's happened to a lot of folks, Electra, I guess. As time goes by.
Yeah, you were saying, I didn't mean to interrupt you. I was just giving you a little back, a little atmospheric.
Can I ask you if you could keep doing it? You know, play a tune.
Play a tune. Well, let's see.
See if we can make him last another 10 minutes.
I was going to say something.
We would have edited it anyway.
You seem to anticipate these things that I managed to restrain myself from uttering. Well, I guess maybe one song that is logical to play alone at the piano and demands a fool to play it when a wonderful lady with a wonderful voice just recorded it, but I will still do mine. I think you were asking me if my feelings were ever hurt by critics. The one guy who said that I sounded like a bullfrog with laryngitis. Well, I'm here to prove him right. She tells him she thinks she needs to be free. He tells her he doesn't understand. She takes his hand. She tells him nothing's working out.
she's so many women that he can't find the one who was his friend. So he's hanging on to half her heart, but he can't end the restless part. So he tells her to hasten down the wind. Then he agrees, he thinks she needs to be free. Then she says she'd rather be with him, but it's just a whim by which she hopes to keep him on the wind. She's so many women that he can't find the one who was his friend. So he's hanging on to half her heart, but he can't have the restless part. So he tells her to hasten down the wind. So he's hanging on to half her heart, but he can't have the restless part. So he tells her to hasten down the wind. He tells her to hasten down the wind.
I like that version too.
Thank you.
It's real good.
I
was hasting down the wind.
If you tell me you like Linda's better though.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you, she does have a set of pipes. What can you say? Yeah, that's the title tune of Linda Ronstadt's new album, Hasten Down the Wind, which Warren has written, of course. Did you write it for her, or did you just write it? Do you ever write songs for people?
No, I don't. I kind of think about people sometimes.
I see.
You know, like you'd write a cello sonata, you think about somebody, the way someone sounds.
A fat ant. Whatever. Warren Zevon, we have a few minutes left. If you want to do one more tune, really be appreciated. I know I don't want to make you work too
You're
much.
You're really working me today.
Yeah.
Hey.
Getting a free concert out of this.
Yeah, why don't you rap for a couple of minutes while I adjust my tunic.
Rap.
What?
Adjust your who?
I don't know.
You were talking about the album, and you're not exactly sure what's going to come out of it and what it's going to be like. Do you have a date, you know, proposed recording date when you're going to begin work on it?
I think about the end of the year.
It's a while, but I guess it's long enough. Yeah. Let everybody catch on to the first one first.
And, yeah, well, I don't want to shovel these out in my hamburgers. I'm in no great hurry.
Well, they become more valuable as time goes in.
I think it's about two-thirds written in my mind anyway. And you like to leave yourself that last third, leave a little room for...
Do you do a lot of last-minute adjusting or writing in the studio? You find yourself...
No, I don't do much of that. But I wouldn't like to think that I couldn't write some more songs between now and December.
For sure.
Is the idea.
I can see that.
So... I mean, theoretically, I guess maybe there are about 11 songs that I'd like to record. But
by the way, is there one song on the album that
I don't like?
They call is there one song on the album that they call the single or the 45 or whatever? Is there one?
I really don't know.
Because reading these reviews, everybody seems to have their favorite, and it's all different. They're all different tunes.
But that makes me feel great.
They like the album. Period.
May not make for a Wooly Bully hit single, but I'm glad everybody has their favorite. I'm glad they are all different.
Excitable Boy. We heard that very first thing. That's okay.
No, I think Bert was referring to himself.
Oh, Bert was referring to himself.
Walked in with a sign. Of course, maybe in closing we could Reprise that.
That's an excellent idea. And,
maybe I'll remember different verses that I forgot the first time. But anyway, you were saying.
Were you one who was like, did you listen to radio when you were younger? Was it a thing that, you know, influenced you? Radio influences you in a lot of different ways. Did it touch you at all?
No, not at all.
Not at all. No. Nope. It's too bad.
Dancing and making out.
Pardon?
Dancing and puberty and stuff. I mean, it was definitely background music for all those activities. But I was sort of aware of the fact that I liked the Everly Brothers and I liked Elvis better than I liked anybody else. But then I don't think it had any influence on me at all. I never listened to it. You know, I played it when I do things.
Background, sort of a thing.
This was a long time ago.
Yeah.
Radio's different now.
It's changed considerably.
I'm different.
Yeah. Everything changes as you go on with time.
It stays the same.
Can you say it would be boring if it didn't change? Was that Everly Brothers experience pleasant for you?
It was great. It was really great.
This was, your first time out on the road then, I guess?
I'd done a little of this and a little of that, but it was as the idea of formally being on the road, really being on the road, a road musician. It was the first real experience like that. It was really, really wonderful. I don't want to wax maudlin on the subject, but it was a great thing. You know, it was a great thing to happen, to do. Waddy Wachtel, and that our salad days before he became the best known, best loved, and highest paid guitarist in America, was playing in a band at the same time. We always enjoyed it, you know. We were always kind of proud of them.
For sure.
It's an interesting point. But,
and you were part of it.
Those oldies didn't get old. You know, all those Bootlow Bryant songs and all those great tunes, and we really enjoyed them every night.
There's something to be said.
There's getting sick of doing the same thing over. There's getting sick of repetition, and then there's, not. We enjoyed it.
There's something to be said for paying dues, I guess, because you get a good experience. I mean, period. You learn a lot of the ins and outs before you're ready to.
Well put.
To do it by yourself, I guess. I don't know. Overnight sensations kind of tend to burn out real quick, you know. It helps if you have the years of roll-up experience, I guess. All right, we have just a few minutes left. A song?
Well, let's see.
The Reprise.
All right, we'll do The Reprise.
Record company.
Since after all,
we all know.
I am the Excitable Boy.
He went down to dinner in his Sunday best. Excitable boy, they all said. And he rubbed a pot roast all over his chest. Excitable boy, they all said. Well, he's just an excitable boy. He took in the 4 a.m. show at the Clark. Excitable boy, they all said. And he bit the usherette's leg like that shark. Excitable boy, they all said. Well, he's just an excitable boy. Excitable boy, they all said. that he's such an excitable boy.
Excitable boy.
Excitable boy.
Warren Zevon. Thank you, for one thing.
I had to play it a second time just so you knew I wasn't kidding. No, I'm kidding, of course.
It's a brand new track, and, you know, it's good to get a second listen to it. But I can always go listen to the tape. We've run out of time and tape.
And tequila, yeah.
And hopefully, you know, next time you'll be around here, you'll be with a band. And, you know, hope to see you in concert, is what all that comes down to. Good luck with the record and the continuing career and perils and...
Imagine.
Voyages of Warren Zevon.
All right.
Have a good morning.
I think it's afternoon, man.
We are WMMS Cleveland.